Welcome to another TCP walkthrough video. I'm Logan, and in today's video, we're going to be going over stock options, mainly ISOs and NSOs. And we're going to be doing that the SuperfastCPA way, which is diving straight into questions to learn the material. If you don't know much about our strategies, make sure you go to superfastcpa.com and check out our free one-hour webinar training where we teach the key ingredients to passing the CPA exam. Again, it's 1 hour, it's free, and it will save you so much time struggling with your process. Before we start, one thing I want to say about this video, we will only be going over 5 questions in this video, whereas members of SuperfastCPA will have access to the full video where we go over 10 questions. So if you like this, then there's more of it if you're a SuperfastCPA member. With all that said, let's dive straight into the questions. Okay, here's question 1. On May 13th, Omega Enterprises grants an employee, Carlos, 120 ISOs with a strike price of $35 per share when the market price is also $35 per share. Carlos exercises all his options on November 29th of the same year when the market price has increased to $55 per share. Calculate the income Carlos should recognize from exercising his ISOs for his tax return for that year. So just a reminder, ISO stands for incentive stock option. And since this is the first question of the video, we don't really know how this works. So let's go ahead and go straight into the answer to learn what exercising an ISO does. Okay, and the answer is $0. For ISOs, there is no taxable income recognized at the time of exercise for regular income tax purposes. This characteristic of ISOs under the tax code is intended to provide tax benefits to employees, aligning their interests with the growth of the company. While the increase in market price does imply a gain on paper, this gain is not taxable upon exercise, but only upon eventual sale of the shares if specific holding period conditions are met. ISOs are a type of equity compensation award, just like RSUs if you've watched that video. Equity compensation refers to the practice of granting company shares or options to purchase shares as part of an employee's compensation. Okay, so incentive stock options, when you exercise them, that is not taxable income in that year. We will talk about what happens when you sell them in a second here, but for ISOs, again, not taxed as ordinary income like RSUs were. All right, let's go ahead and go to the next question. Okay, here's question 2. Rebecca was granted 100 ISOs by her employer, Vertex Innovations, on April 10th with a strike price of $10 per share when the market price was also $10 per share. She exercises these options on April 11th the following year when the market price has risen to $20 per share. Rebecca decides to sell all her shares on June 15th of the same year the options were exercised, when the market price is $30 per share. What tax treatment will Rebecca's sale receive due to the holding period rules? Okay, again, what are the holding period rules for ISOs? You probably don't know. Let's go ahead and go into the answer to understand what happens when you sell your ISO. So the gain will be taxed as ordinary income because she did not meet the required holding period. Okay, so let's learn about this. For ISOs to receive favorable tax treatment, where gains are taxed at the long-term capital gains rate, Rebecca must hold the shares for at least 1 year after the exercise date and 2 years after the grant date. In this scenario, Rebecca sells the shares just a few months after exercising and less than 2 years from the grant date. Therefore, the gain from the sale of the shares, $20 per share, from the exercise price to the sale price, will be taxed as ordinary income because she did not meet the required holding periods. So specifically for ISOs, when you sell them, for that capital gain to be taxed as a long-term capital gain, you have to have held those ISOs at least 1 year from the date you exercised them, and 2 years from the date that option was granted to you. If you don't meet both those requirements, that ISO capital gain will be taxed as ordinary income. And that's pretty much what you need to know for ISOs. On the exercise date, they're not taxed. And then when you sell them, unless you meet these requirements, the capital gain is taxed as ordinary income. Now let's go ahead and look at NSOs. Okay, here is question 3. Jordan is granted 200 NSOs by his employer, Fusion Enterprises, on May 15th with a strike price of $10 per share when the market price is also $10 per share. Jordan exercises these options on May 15th of the next year when the market price has increased to $25 per share. Calculate the amount of income Jordan will recognize as taxable on the day he exercises his NSOs, assuming he exercises all his options. Okay, NSO, that's a non-qualified stock option, just in case you don't know what that is. And is a non-qualified stock option the same as an incentive stock option when they're exercised? Is it going to be taxed as ordinary income or not? Let's go ahead and look at the answer to find out how it works. And the answer is, it would be $3,000. So it looks like it is different from an ISO. When NSOs are exercised, the difference between the exercise price and the market price at the time of exercise is recognized as ordinary income. For Jordan, the difference per share is $15, so that's the market price less the exercise price. And since he exercises 200 shares, that results in $3,000 of additional taxable income. This income is reported as part of his W-2 wages and is taxed at ordinary income rates. Okay, so kind of similar to RSUs, again, if you've watched that video. However, the ordinary income that's taxed is not just the fair market value at that date, like an RSU. For this, it's the difference between the strike price and the market price on the date of exercise. All right, let's go ahead and go to the next question. Okay, here's question 4. Jessica is granted 250 NSOs by her company, Bright Tech, on June 1st with a strike price of $20 per share, when the market price is also $20. She exercises these options on June 1st of the following year, when the market price has increased to $35 per share. Jessica sells all the shares on December 5th of the same year, when the market price is $45 per share. So we need to calculate the total gain that she'll recognize on the sale of her shares and determine how this gain is taxed. Assume she exercises all her options. Okay, so basically it's asking us, what is the total income that's going to be taxed here? Okay, you learned a little bit about this in the previous question. The only question is, how is the gain going to work? Go ahead and pause the video, see if you can figure this out, and when you're ready, come back and we will look at the answer together. All right, and the answer is that there would be $3,750 of ordinary income and a $2,500 capital gain. So let's look at the whole calculation. The calculation of Jessica's financial outcome from exercising and selling her NSOs involves two components. So first, the income at exercise, and that would be the difference between the strike price and the market price at the time of exercise as taxed as ordinary income. And again, that's the market price less the strike price, $15 per share, times 250 shares. That's $3,750. The gain realized from the increase in value after exercising the options until the sale of the stock is taxed as a capital gain. This is calculated as the sale price per share less the exercise price per share. And that gives you $10 per share. And that will be a total gain of $2,500. So she has ordinary income and $2,500 of capital gain at the time of sale. All right, let's go ahead and go to the next question. Okay, here is question 5. Elena is evaluating the differences between being granted incentive stock options, or ISOs, and non-qualified stock options, or NSOs, by her employer Tech Global. Which of the following statements accurately describes a fundamental difference between ISOs and NSOs? Okay, we haven't really learned about this yet. Are ISOs only granted to management, or are NSOs taxed at the time of grant, while ISOs are taxed at the time of exercise? We know that one's wrong. So take a second, read through this, see if you can figure out which the correct answer is based off of what we learned so far. And if not, let's go ahead and look at the answer. Okay, and the answer is that NSOs require the holder to pay tax on the bargain element as ordinary income at the time of exercise, whereas ISOs do not lead to immediate regular income tax consequences when exercised. So you probably knew that after looking at the different options. And this is a big difference between ISOs and NSOs. For ISOs, when they're exercised, they do not create a taxable event for regular income tax purposes. However, the spread between the exercise price and the market price at the time of exercise may be subject to alternate minimum tax, and we'll learn about that in another video. The favorable capital gains treatment is only realized if the shares are sold at least 1 year after exercise and 2 years after the date the options were granted. And now NSOs, when they are exercised, the difference between the exercise price and the market value of the stock at that time is taxed as ordinary income in the year of exercise. Kind of similar to RSUs, but RSUs is just the fair market value at that date. This income is subject to regular income taxes and must be reported as part of the individual's W-2 wages. All right, we've learned a lot about ISOs and NSOs in just 5 questions. Before we go any further, let's go ahead and do another part of the SuperFast CPA strategy called Pillar Topics. Now, if you don't know much about our strategies, again, Pillar Topics is the idea that as you're going through questions to learn the material, you will see things that keep popping up in the questions. These are the concepts that are obviously important and that you're supposed to be learning from your review course. You've seen them in like 3 or 4 questions throughout your study session. So let's go ahead and look at the pillar topics for this video. Okay, here are the pillar topics. Okay, there are typically 2 kinds of stock options, ISOs and NSOs, at least for the CPA exam. ISOs are typically only for employees and are not taxed at the time of exercise. However, the spread, or the difference between the market price and the strike price at exercise, can be subject to AMT. And again, AMT is something we'll cover in a different video. If ISOs are sold, the gain is treated as ordinary income for tax unless it is held for more than 1 year after the exercise date and for more than 2 years after the date the options were granted. Now, NSOs are less restrictive, but they are taxed upon exercise. On the date of exercise, the difference between the strike price and the market price is included in ordinary income, usually on the employee's W-2. Upon sale, any capital gain is taxed as either short-term or long-term based off of the exercise date. All right, those were the pillar topics for this video. And that is the end of the 5 questions for this video. Again, a reminder that members of SuperfastCPA will have access to the full 10-question video to get more practice. So if you liked this, make sure you go check out our SuperfastCPA training webinar we have on superfastcpa.com, where we go over the key ingredients to passing the CPA exam. Again, it's only 1 hour, it's free, it is something you do not want to miss. If you liked going through questions as your main learning material, make sure you check out our SuperfastCPA app. We have 5 question mini quizzes that you can easily access on your phone all throughout your day. If you liked this video, make sure to like it and leave a comment. I hope this was helpful, and I will see you in the next video.